Hello everyone, my name is Gabriel for HotCars.com, and today we're checking out what is essentially the last convertible, affordable rear-wheel drive sports car you can get with a manual in the United States with this. It's the 2021 Mazda MX-5 Miata Grand Touring. Now I'm really excited to take a look at this little car. We're gonna take it out for a spin like usual, but before we do any of that, I wanna make sure you guys like this video and subscribe to the channel. Now, instead of doing my usual sort of walk around when I kind of talk about design and dimensions, I figured we could transition, because if we're completely honest, you're only looking at the MX-5 for one of two reasons: how much it costs and how well it drives. Now, I could stand outside and point out how small it is and how good or bad it looks, but that's not what matters here, because with this car, the only important thing is how it makes you feel when you're out on the road. Now, the car I'm driving today is the Grand Touring trim, which is set to be a little bit softer than the Club. You don't get a limited slip diff. But remember, this particular trim is meant to be more of a cruiser, and that's exactly what I'm doing. I've got the top down, it's a Sunday afternoon, I've got a nice road, and I'm just cruising along. It's not about speed, it's not about going at the limit per se, it's just about how this car makes you feel. And so the Miata has been around for over three decades at this point. It was originally introduced in the late 1980s, and during that time it's been basically the sort of apex predator of the affordable sports car segment. There have been a ton of other competitors, especially when it was new, but they've kind of all pretty much died out at this point. And over that time, the Miata has been kind of in a class of its own. And before you say S2000, yes, I recognize that the S2000 was around for like 10 years, but it was much more expensive than Miata. Granted, it was a better performing car, it was more rigid and arguably better looking, but it was more expensive. And as a result, it wasn't priceable, like let's say directly in competition with the MX-5. And because of that, well, it's dead. Most of the competitors against the MX-5 are dead, but the MX-5 survives and lives on. Now, there are two big benefits for that. The main benefit is that Mazda's been building these things for three decades, and as a result, they've gotten pretty good at it. There's no like sort of main drawbacks of this car that have persisted for decades. Almost every little imperfection about this car has been ironed out, and you can tell based on how long this model has lived on. Now, one key difference from other models that have lived, you know, long lives, especially sporty cars, is that for the most part, they've all gotten bigger, more powerful, and heavier. Now, the Miata, this ND generation Miata, is, at least on a footprint basis, very similar to the standard original Miata, but it makes a ton more horsepower. Now, just as a refresher, we have a 2-liter naturally aspirated engine up front, develops 181 horsepower and 151 pounds-feet of torque. Now, the important bit about that is that all that power goes to the rear wheels exclusively via a 6-speed manual transmission, although you can get an automatic as well. Now, there are a few key drawbacks if you go for the automatic, because the Bilstein sport suspension is only available with the manual. That means if you go for the automatic, you're inherently going to have a bit of a softer car. Regardless, it's still very, very light. We're talking about a car that, you know, weighs anywhere between 2300 and 2400 pounds, which is staggering. Considering, for example, the BRZ and the Toyota 86, those weighed in around 2800 pounds, and they've only gotten heavier with their newest generation. But the Miata stays true to form and sort of perfecting its original formula. Again, nothing about the Miata, even this brand new one, the 2021, doesn't reinvent the wheel, but what it does, what it actually is supposed to do, which is make you feel good, it does very, very well. Now, what I'm driving is the MX-5 convertible, and I understand that all MX-5s are convertible in some way, shape, or form, but this one is the soft top, and there's a couple notable benefits to that. The main thing is that the soft top goes up and down about as quickly as you can move your arm because it's mechanical. Now, if you want a hard top, you can get the Miata RF, but that has an extra charge because it's a metal folding roof and it's done electronically, it's not done manually. But again, main differences between the soft top car and the hard top car is that with the hard top car, you're going to get a ton more sound deadening, whereas in the soft top car, there's a lot of sound that comes into the cabin because you have a much lighter material that's separating you and the rest of the world. For the most part, I think having the convenience of putting the top up and down basically instantly and all the time is definitely worth it. And also the fact that if it starts to rain, you know, it's South Florida, it totally might, I can just put the top up. Even if I'm going at a decent amount of speed, I don't have to totally stop or slow down significantly in order to be able to actuate it. Now, in terms of how the MX-5 Miata drives, as I said before, this is the Grand Touring. It's a little bit softer. It doesn't have the limited slip differential. For the most part, you're not gonna notice that if you're driving it in a city most of the time. But what you are gonna notice is that this Bilstein suspension, fairly stiff. It's pretty bouncy, you're gonna notice, see? And also you'll notice the camera itself will shake throughout this whole video because the suspension is a little on the stiff side. Now, that doesn't mean that the Miata is super duper planted. There is a good amount of body roll when you attack corners at any decent amount of speed. But that's not necessarily a bad thing because I get it, the idea of wanting your car to be a super performer that's totally flat and whatever, but that's not really fun in the real world. I think a little bit of body roll is actually not a bad thing, and that's exactly what the MX-5 Miata gives me, at least in this configuration. Again, you can go higher spec, you can get bigger brakes, Recaro seats, and you could do that, but then again, that's gonna drive the price up significantly because as I mentioned, this is a Grand Touring model. This one starts at $31,000, but it can easily go up from there. Now, I touched on those Recaro seats, and that's an option that this car does not have. This one has the standard, let's call it normal seats, which are supposed to be more daily driver friendly, but for me, they don't have a ton of adjustment, and if you've got a little bit of extra COVID weight on you, they're not gonna be super comfortable, and you don't get a lot of lower back support. Again, these are the things that you have to sort of put up with if you want a tiny, super lightweight sports car, because you don't get a big puffy seat that's super incredibly adjustable because there simply isn't a whole lot of space. And speaking of space, I'm about as big as I would want to be in a car like this. I'm 5'10" tall, and I find myself already feeling a little cramped in here. The passenger side is extra cramped because some of the leg room is compromised, but again, this is kind of what you have to give up if you want a super lightweight sports car. And frankly, I'm really glad that the MX-5 is still in production because the 6-speed manual transmission, it is ridiculously easy to use. It's ridiculously easy to be very smooth with. The clutch is very light. The steering is very light. In terms of just going for a drive, driving this car is so effortless that you can kind of just focus on having the wind go through your hair. You can see the outside, you can smell, especially if you're sort of outdoors like I am right now. Now, just because this is a tiny car doesn't mean you don't get a lot of usable options, because for example, you get heated seats, you have this nice 7-inch touchscreen. Well, it is a touchscreen when you're like slowing down or you're stopped, because when you're on the move, the touchscreen portion of it does not work. You have to use a little controller in the center. Again, not the end of the world, but just something to consider. So now that all that drivey feely stuff is out of the way, let's talk about what you actually need to know about the 2021 Miata, starting with its dimensions, because this car is just over 12.8 feet long. It is 5.6 feet wide and just over 4 feet tall. So when I say this is a tiny car, I really, really mean it. While it might not be the main purchasing decision as to what might steer you to an MX-5 Miata, I think it's worth we talk about how it looks, because remember, this is a very tiny car and it has a very sort of simple aesthetic, and it's actually a pretty good thing because I don't think you want something too overcomplicated on such a small platform. Now, because it is so simple is why it kind of still looks sharp and modern today, even though this design is a few years old. For the most part, I think it looks great. I know a lot of people don't like the sort of sharp, kind of aggressive looking headlights, but I like them. We've got just over 4 cubic feet of space in here, which is frankly not a lot. It's not a car you're gonna take grocery shopping or anything like that, because there isn't a ton you can really fit back here. Also, don't think you're gonna get away with stuffing something in the interior, because as you'll notice from that passenger footwell, there isn't a whole lot of space. In fact, passenger legroom is actually fairly compromised in this car. So if you're gonna go on a trip in this car, make sure to pack light. Now, I know I talked about the engine during the little drive portion, but I think it's worth revisiting, because under the hood, we have a naturally aspirated 4-cylinder engine developing 181 horsepower and 151 pound-feet of torque. Now, what's important about that is that it makes that peak power at 7,000 RPM, which is why you have to rev it so high to actually really get going anywhere. But that's why this car is actually fun to drive, because you really, really have to put your foot in it to get the most out of it. Now, realistically, you should be getting around 26 mpg in the city and about 34 mpg on the highway, which is highly achievable as long as you don't have your foot in it like I have the past week or so. But if you do behave, you can get those figures fairly easily. So it might not be super comfortable as a daily driver, but at least it is affordable. Now, I know I've said a lot of really positive things about this car so far, but I think it's time we talk about price, because even though I said it's affordable, it could really easily become very expensive. And that's because you can get a base one of these cars for $26,830. That's the sport trim. It's the base one. But this is not a base. This is a Grand Touring, which comes in at $31,700. And from there, with options and stuff, you can easily cross the $35,000 line. And if you go for a higher trim, like for example, the Club, with Brembo brakes, Recaro seats, that sort of thing, you can get into the 40s with these cars, which again is a ton of money for a tiny sports car that's supposed to be the affordable option. But again, I have to give credit. There is the sport one, which you can get, especially if you're gonna track it or modify it or something like that. Get the base one and then put all the modifications you want onto it, and then you've got yourself your little track car ready to go. But again, it is kind of, it can be expensive, but it's still worth the price in my eyes, at least. So there we have it, the 2021 Mazda Miata MX-5. And is it perfect? No, but then again, no car really is. But keep in mind, this is small, it is cramped, and it is very, very stiff. But then again, those are the trade-offs you have to give up when you want such a small, lightweight, and lively sports car such as this. Because once you get behind the wheel, it all really does come together. And frankly, this formula hasn't changed in 3 decades. It's the same recipe as the car we got back in the 90s. And as everything becomes sort of turbocharged and bloated, this feels even more refreshing now because it stands out. And frankly, I really want to see this car live on, because the more it sticks to this original recipe and sort of perseveres through time, the more special it becomes. So honestly, this car is really, really hard to beat, and there's no secret why it's the only one standing. And with that, I want to thank you guys so much for watching this video. Make sure you guys like and subscribe to the channel, because it helps us out a ton, and I'll see you again really soon.